Interactive Radio Night with Steve Lamacq and Joe Whiley.
Hi and welcome to Interactive Radio Night, the future brought to you in 3 hours.
Between now and 10, we'll be telling you why your entertainment world will never be the same again.
We'll be talking games, TV, music and movies.
Also, we'll be explaining the internet and how you could get all your music and videos online without ever leaving your home.
So if you've got a computer and a connection to the internet, stay tuned for details of how to get involved in the show. But if you're not hooked up to the net and know very little about it, don't worry. We'll be explaining it all tonight with the help of Rob Newman.
It's Rob Newman. Oh, come on, you must have heard of me. Can you send me an email back?
And you could win a full starter kit for the internet and a multimedia state-of-the-art PC.
But it's not all geek talk about the net. We've got plenty of music tonight as well, along with interviews with bands like Belly, The Grid, Yellow, The Future Sound of London, and Peter Gabriel.
The Orb, Megadeth, The Grid, Goldie, Pete Shelley, The Black Dog and The Beastie Boys.
And playing exclusive new tracks live from their own studios just before 10, we'll have Orbital.
Also, top DJs Sure as Pure will be mixing live on the show from the UK's premier interactive haunt, Cafe Siberia, in London.
And if you are online tonight, then you have the technology to interview Blur. Also, you can make your own Blur track, which may end up as a B-side to one of the band's singles.
In a moment, we'll be talking to Blur, but first, here's Space Captain William Franklin's guide to the rest of the show.
Welcome to the brave new world. A world where computers run our lives and silently communicate in a parallel universe. William Gibson calls it cyberspace.
I always tell people that cyberspace is where the bank keeps your money. The place in which a long-distance telephone conversation takes place.
But if this world sounds frightening to you, then follow the example of the Future Sound of London.
People are quite scared of machines still, and we've overcome that to such a degree that we managed to push through what is perceived as being a bad thing, the technological sound, into the area beyond.
And in that world beyond, interactive is everything. Interactive games, interactive movies, and interactive music. Peter Gabriel.
The exciting thing about all the interactive stuff is the capacity to allow the participator to get inside and become the artist and make artistic and creative decisions themselves.
And you can do it all from your living room. Shopping, working, dating, with just one black box.
I think a lot of the functions that you can perform with this box, we really haven't got the names for yet.
But be warned, while you're playing games, ordering pizza, or entering virtual reality, the real world might come knocking on your door. Terry Pratchett.
Virtual reality is fine, but there is a real reality out there. And in the real reality, you can starve to death. And if we shut ourselves away in our little towers with our TV sets strapped in front of our eyes, one day those people are bursting in and gut us like a clam.
And cyberspace can also be a dangerous place. On the internet, where computers communicate, the sheriffs are still fighting the outlaws.
The internet is a frontier in the same ways that the Wild West of old America was a frontier. Many places uncharted, many rules that haven't been laid down.
And the new outlaws are the hackers, and none more infamous than New York's fiber optic.
Hacking is all about exploration, discovery, understanding, sharing of information.
And as well as information, the internet could become the main way to get music. Thomas Dolby.
Really what a record company does is it puts a piece of plastic in shops and street corners. And that is not going to be the way in 20 or 30 years that people are getting most of their music. So what exactly is the record company's contribution going to be?
It's also a place to discuss anything, especially for people who have an obsession with sex.
People wearing leather, to people wielding whips, to, you know, men in diapers.
And there's nobody to stop you talking about diapers or anything you want to. Techno musician Moby thinks it should stay that way.
If someone wants to put racist pornography on the net, that's their prerogative. I don't want anyone controlling the information that's on the net.
So it's big, it's exciting, it's controversial. And net freedom fighter John Perry Barlow thinks it'll save the world.
This is probably the biggest thing to hit humanity since the capture of fire.
So join us on our journey into cyberspace.
So that's just some of the stuff coming up in the show in the next 3 hours. This night could either baffle, patronise or go horribly wrong, such as the subject matter. Hopefully it will inform, entertain and go wonderfully smoothly. Ever the optimist. If you have an email, and I mean if you can email us, the address is interact@bbc.co.uk. Send us an email, interact@bbc.co.uk. Throughout the night we're going to be hearing from celebrity net surfers, those bands who just can't live life without their laptop and modem. First up tonight, Belly.
Hi, this is Tanya from Belly.
And hi, this is Tom from Belly.
This old man I've talked about broke his own heart, poured it in the ground.
There's definitely a danger that people feel like they're completely anonymous when they're on the internet, or they feel they can be completely anonymous when they're on the internet, which isn't in fact the case.
In some ways it's almost easier than a journal for some reason. I mean, I go on there and we go into like Belly Mail and people are telling me things that they would, you know, telling us things that they would never say. Their mouths would never form those words. And there's something cool about that in a way, because it means that the body and all its awkwardness has been eliminated and it's kind of just a head floating in space. But there's something really dangerous about that too, because then you're giving up too much information. It's almost like your information isn't as sacred as your body is, you know, and it should be. There should be more courtship online, a little more of a wooing time, not so much information so fast.
Belly and Seal My Fate from the album King. Now, one of the biggest and best parts of the internet is called the World Wide Web, or the WWW. It's like a virtual universe with millions of pages, and it's got like loads of information and musings. Lots of bands have their own websites, as they're called, and naturally, trying to be in there, we've got one too. The addresses, though, hardly trip off the tongue. Make of this what you will.
The Radio 1 Interactive Night has its own pages on the World Wide Web at http://www.bbcnc.org.uk/online/radiointeract/.
It's the Interactive Radio Night. I'm Radio 1, and I'm down at one of the coolest spots in London if you're a net surfer, Cafe Siberia, which is, well, a cafe, basically, where you can get hooked up on the internet and have a cappuccino while you're sitting around. With me, joining us for tonight's show, we have Dave Rowntree, drummer from Blur. How long have you been on the net yourself?
About 3 years, something like that.
How did you get into it?
Well, I used to be a computer programmer before I was a drummer. Sorry about that, but I was.
You're sort of fulfilling the stereotype slightly here. When do you have time to spend, though, actually sitting down in front of a screen?
Not very often these days, actually. But when we're in the studio, there's not a lot going on a fair bit of the time, so...
Okay, explain IRC, which is what we're doing tonight.
IRC is like a big communications programme. Everyone can log on to a particular channel and send messages to each other. It's just like a big kind of conversation group.
Right. Okay, we'll be coming back and reading some of the conversations which Dave's going to be having with people who are joining us on the net tonight, and here's how to get involved.
To talk to Blur, you need to access our internet relay chat channel. It's at stalk.doc.ic.ac.uk, Radio 1. That's stalk.doc.ic.ac.uk, Radio 1.
There'll be more from Blur as the evening progresses tonight. Now, if getting on the internet is something that completely bewilders you, I'm here to learn as well. I'm kind of in that state at the moment. Don't worry, you are not the only one. If you want some help and explanations about what the hell is going on, then we've got it here.
Call the helpline now. 0345 600 444. 0345 600 444.
Okay, so that's a number to ring. And if you want to discover what it takes to get online, we persuaded fellow Luddite Rob Newman to become a nerd. It wasn't that difficult, actually.
And I'm here with Ed Ricketts from Mit Magazine in Tottenham Court Road in a computer shop. I don't know the first thing about anything here. Tell me what I need to get on the net.
Right, well, obviously, the first thing you're going to need is a computer of some sort.
Okay. Do you need to have a computer that's over a certain amount of money or a certain type of sophistication before you can get on the internet?
No, that's the good thing about getting on the net. Pretty much any computer will do.
But you need, like, a telephone thing.
You need what's called a modem, which is basically a box which connects between your PC and the telephone socket and converts all the data coming out of your PC into a phone signal, basically, and sends it off to wherever you're connected to.
I'm looking around at all these shelves thinking, which one of these electrical things is a modem? Like, what does it look like?
Well, basically, just a small white box, interestingly enough, with some lights on it. They all look pretty much the same.
Well, should we go and see if we can find one? We bought the stuff, but, you know, how do I actually get, like, on the net?
The next thing is to get yourself sorted with an account with a service provider.
Right.
Now, there are quite a few of these days. There used to be two or three, and now there's about 20, I think.
Right.
And they are the people that will give you access to the internet. Most providers offer full net access, which is email, news, FTP.
Which is anyone else I know with a PC.
That's right.
I can just send them things.
You can send them messages, pictures, sounds, whatever. Anything that can be sent as data.
You're like a recording of your own voice you can sort of send.
That's right, yeah.
the telephone we have invented. News is what? That's like a bulletin board. But you've got very real sort of net aficionados for the news, is that?
Not really, no. Some people have trouble sort of understanding the concept of these news groups. Basically what it is, it's like thousands and thousands of little user groups, each with their own notice board. And what they do is they post messages to the notice board. Everyone else in the group can read it.
Are these like special interest groups?
Most of them are special interest groups.
For example?
Alt.sex, of course, which is the most infamous news group.
What's the percentage of men on the net? It's about 90% male, isn't it? And 98% virgins. And
it would seem that way from reading some of the groups. Not that I do, obviously, right. From what people have said.
Just contribute. I do think there's like a huge reservoir of bitterness in the net. But is that just me being negative?
Then if you want bitterness, you go to alt.bitterness. I mean, there's a group called that.
You're joking.
No, there really is.
All right.
And it's full of sad and lonely souls, so
I'll probably get a free prescription.
The flame is basically an abusive attack on another net user.
Yeah.
By email or through a newsgroup posting. And these things called flame wars erupt, where basically two or three people start slagging each other off and they get into a huge verbal fight until they piss off the rest of the group big time.
So what am I paying per month? And if I just for what I want, which is like email and then possibly www?
The cheapest one is around £10 a month, and that's it. No connect
then
time charges.
Calls and everything as well. So.
Yeah, obviously you have to pay for the calls. What happens is you phone what's called a point of presence, or POP. You usually find there's one fairly near you, a local phone call's distance away. So what you do is basically phone that computer, and then that computer links you to the rest of the world. So what sort of thing are you after from the net, apart from the pornography?
No, I don't want that. I think I want to talk to friends. I've got a couple of friends who've got PCs. I want to sort of chat to them. It's like when you go into an encyclopedia, you don't really know what you're interested in, but then you think, oh, that's interesting, and then that leads you to another thing, that leads to another thing.
Yeah.
So I think I just want to sort of find out about it, just because I feel a bit of a yokel and don't really know what's going on and stuff.
Well, if you're feeling particularly localish at the moment and you want to get online, we've got five special Radio 1 starter packs to give to the internet. I mean, to get onto the internet to give away. We're going to give you an account for 6 months, a fast modem, and a book on all you need to know about the internet. And all you have to do is answer this particular question. Which Radio 1 series spawned Rob Newman and played its part in his meteoric rise to fame? That's which Radio 1 series spawned Rob Newman and played its part in his meteoric rise to fame. And you can get in touch with us like this.
Ring now on 0171 637 4343. 0171 637 4343.
Okay, so you can get in touch with us at Now Like That. And the book that we're giving away tonight has been written by one of our guests, who is indeed Davey Winder, who's putting his thumbs up already and has been sneering and laughing at all the carts we've been putting out tonight with the internet addresses, the email addresses, which I was quite surprised at. And well, Davey,
they're funny.
I know, it just sounds so bizarre.
Incredibly bizarre. I mean, you know, who wants to hear dot ick? Dot ick, it's terrible. How do you spell ick?
Yeah, exactly.
ICH, mate.
That is the voice of Matt Black. So we've got Davey Winder, who's a bit of a net guru. How did that come about?
Basically, I've been using the net for a long while. Started to write about it for a living. People come to me now, and supposedly I'm a net guru. I'm just a net user, really.
But why should you bother?
Why should I bother using the net?
Yeah, why should anybody bother using the net?
It's new technology. Why should anybody have bothered using the telephone 20 years ago? Or why should anybody have bothered watching television? But it's here, it's now.
What would you say to people like suffering from chronic technophobia?
Get out of my face.
And Matt, what about you? How did you get involved?
I've just been into technology for a long time. You've messed around with computers for getting on for 20 years now. The internet is something that's grown up and sort of matured over the last few years. It's still got a long way to go, but I think it is probably the most interesting communications network in existence at the moment. And that has, you know, far-reaching implications for a lot of things.
You run Ninja Tunes, the record label, and also Hex Media. What is that?
Hex and Ninja and Colcut, they're sort of various names as myself and various people working on projects with a lot of music involvement, but also software, future media, incorporating visuals, and using the internet as well. So Hex is basically the part of that which deals mainly with software and the technology side of things.
Okay, so you are Mr. Multimedia. The pair of you are going to stay with us for the rest of the show. I feel like I'm hosting the word now because that's the phrase that they always use. We're going to talk about CD-ROMs now. They've kind of spawned their own industry. There are loads of magazines that I keep seeing on the racks and they've just become incredibly popular for all kinds of stuff like encyclopedias, reference, games and even porn. Pete Tong, we knew he'd kind of stamp and scream if we didn't let him look at this. CD-ROMs, are they good for music? And what the hell are they, really?
Technology. In case of emergency, click me.
Listen, David.
Imagine if you could take a movie, your favourite LP, an encyclopedia, 10 picture story books, and get them all into one place on one piece of plastic. That's basically what a CD-ROM is.
By the end of the century, in the next 5 years, we will find it very difficult to find an album, a CD album that is, that doesn't have an interactive audio-visual interface.
Guy Sneesby, editor of CD-ROM magazine, and Graham Brown Martin from EXP with his vision of the interactive future. One of the first major artists to get involved with CD-ROM was Peter Gabriel. He immediately appreciated the new technology and released Explorer 1 a year ago.
Before you go any further, you've got to solve this puzzle. Can you find the right combination of features to make up my face?
Gabriel's the guide round his real-world studio complex, and the journey is non-linear. With a CD-ROM, you can use any piece in any order. Peter Gabriel.
The exciting thing about all the interactive stuff is the capacity to allow the participator, if you like, to get inside and become the artist. The transition is from becoming the supplier of a singular journey from one point to another, that you provide an environment that is hopefully interesting and inspiring for people to muck around in and make artistic and creative decisions themselves.
Hello, my name's Richard Evans. This is the production room. I'm having some trouble with a mix of digging in the dirt. Come on in and give me a hand.
What our radio listeners are now missing, of course, is Richard and his bad hair day. So if we far away here and hit play, we have four tracks, bass, drums, guitar, which actually has little keyboards with it, and voice. And you have the faders and on-off switches, and you can save and vary and expand on your mixes.
Thanks. Explorer was Gabriel's first multimedia release, and he's got more out this year. But many other big names are now in on the act. Prince, Mike Oldfield, Todd Rundgren, and David Bowie. But most of the critical acclaim for music CD-ROMs has gone to underground artists like cult American outfit The Residents. Their non-linear storytelling music and bizarre visuals were just waiting to get onto CD-ROM. Resident Hardy.
So often The Residents' works are actually stories. So Freak Show is actually a series of short stories about various freaks in this freak show. It's like Wanda the Worm Woman. Her act is that she eats worms. And so if you sneak backstage and get behind the tent, well, you can get into her trailer. When you find her Bible, you find that she's marked every phrase about worms in the Bible. And you can go through her Bible, and you can also read every phrase about worms if you so desire to.
She wiggles and jiggles like a tub of rubber blubber. It's Wanda. Wanda's a worm woman.
The concept of rock music or something has been so defined for 50 years now. People expect music to sound a certain way. With CD-ROMs, you don't have any situation at all where people have an expectation. They don't know what it is. They don't know what it should be. You know, the Residents themselves have said that they figured that they can do this for a few years, maybe a couple of years maybe, before the whole thing is totally taken over for the Starbase system. The Residents are totally run over by the Madonnas or Michael Jacksons of CD-ROM.
But is everyone so keen to interact with music anyway? The critics aren't so sure. Guy Sneesby, editor of CD-ROM magazine and Wired multimedia journalist Scott Rosenberg.
Most CD-ROMs that are out there really suck. It's sort of this amazing bandwagon that media companies all around the world have jumped on because they're desperate not to get left behind.
The big problem that the music industry has still got to solve is that music is essentially linear. There's only so many times you want to interact with your favorite music in an active way, whereas you'd play an audio CD hundreds of times over a period of years.
But for Graham Brown Martin, head of EXP, and at the forefront of the technology since developing the first interactive music CD for New Order in the 80s, there's a whole generation disenfranchised by the mainstream music business, and they want more than just music.
Now, there's a number of things that have affected that generation. There's more media saturation than ever before. We have, 30 or so television channels in the UK alone. There are so many other entertainment formats. Music is still important to that culture, but not as important. It has become a background activity. We are going through a change in the way that people use media in general, and music in particular.
EXP has been developing a number of as-yet unreleased titles with U2 and The Shaman, and a recent buyout by Viacom should at least ensure the release of one by Nine Inch Nails.
What we wanted to do here was to take the, if you like, the vibe of Nine Inch Nails, and what would that be like to interact with? We've developed a number of sort of technologies such as mood states. So when you put the disc in your CD player, it wakes up in a particular frame of mood, anything from sullen to really, really kissed off. It will show parts of the video, not necessarily all of the video, and the emotion that's trying to get conveyed to the consumer is one of complete frustration. So now the video has decided to go. This is the video you really wanted to see because this is the one that MTV wouldn't show. And here it's on the screen at the moment. It's corrupted the screen and now it's crashed.
Brown Martin has developed his products for CDI, which plugs into your television instead of your computer. But another new product, CD Plus, has been launched this month in the States. Dubbed the Return of the Album Sleeve, it builds on earlier experiments to add optional visuals to your CDs. Musician Thomas Dolby, now with his own multimedia company, Headspace, was one of the enthusiasts at the launch. So what sort of thing will CD Plus show you?
I'm a pop singer called Joe Blow, and I've got my home studio, and I get my Hi8 camera, and I wander around, and I'm behind the camera giving you a commentary. Then in the meantime, we could also scan in the sketches that he did on the tour bus during the 73 World Tour, and maybe the napkin on which he wrote the first lyrics to his hit song while he was sitting in a restaurant in Detroit.
CD Plus will add around 12 minutes worth of pictures to an existing audio album. And it will end up a lot cheaper than the £40 to £50 of a full-on CD-ROM. But already, compression techniques giving up to 122 minutes of video on a CD are being developed. So what does the future hold? Last words to Scott Rosenberg and Peter Gabriel.
In the long run, I think it will simply become, oh, I'm buying an album of videos and interviews and information about this band, and, oh, it comes with the music as well.
CD-ROM is a limited life platform. I expect it to last sort of 3 to 7 years. And I think there are going to be a lot of other formats. And the capacity for online delivery is obviously going to increase enormously. And I think that'll pay off better.
CD-ROM and Kiss the Frog. Now, down at the Cyber Cafe in London, we've got Blur doing an online interview. That's over in the other corner at the moment. We're going to be checking on the kind of incisive questioning that people have been coming up with tonight. That'll be a bit later. Also with us, though, we have DJ Sure Is Pure, Danny and Kelvin. They're here to mix for us later in the programme. And they're doing it with samples that we've put up on our website on the internet. And people have voted for their favourite ones. Here's a few examples you're going to give to us now, chaps, then.
This is our favourite one over here.
Is it favourite or just the easiest to work with?
It's caught me out because I can't hear anything that's going on here as well. But this is our favourite one. Down here we got some other stuff as well, which is like, we voted for that one.
That one there, it's called Wow, apparently.
So it's very sweet. Is it a difficult job? Is it going to be a difficult job putting all these pieces together later on?
No, not really. It's just sort of stick them in a sampler and play them. That's it.
Make a mix out of it, yeah.
It's confidence all round from Kelvin and Danny from Sure Is Pure. They'll be back with us later on. In the meantime, here's another celebrity net surfer, Richard Norris from The Grid.
Well, all right, watch out, watch out.
I've made a big point of not actually revealing that I'm someone from The Grid because I'm sure we just get like loads of bizarre mail. I found it quite fascinating because initially I thought like the idea of the internet was quite dry really, and I thought it would be Trainspotter and stuff and a bit kind of computer boffins that seemed to have their own language. It seemed to be like, you know, you had to know all the little funny signs that looked like smiley faces and stuff like this. But actually when I got into like reading all the stuff in all the dance pages on the internet and like on, you know, various home pages, I found it a lot more kind of warm and human than I thought it would be really. And you know, there'd be people like writing in and saying, I'm coming to London this weekend, where shall I go? And then like loads of replies saying, well, this club's good and there's this to do and stuff like this, which I thought was really nice. You know, there is quite a kind of warm element to it. It can be quite ferocious as well. I mean, there's been quite a few big raging battles going on on some of the dance pages. I mean, there was one that we were involved in quite recently where the guy from the Rednecks logged on and said, hi, I'm from the Rednecks, we're number one in the UK, and instantly got about 300 letters of abuse, which we thought was quite heartening. And then that turned into a kind of Grid versus the Rednecks battle, with people slagging off the Rednecks and then people slagging off us and then people defending us and saying, you know, they did this first and they did that. And it was just really interesting to watch. You know, and you get people with really passionate views on it, which I think is really nice. You're not going to find it anywhere else. You're not going to find it in a magazine or anything. Particularly for me, as someone in a band, to just actually read what people are thinking about us on the street, rather than just reading something that a journalist is saying, it's much more valid to me than reading what someone writes in the NME.
You're listening to The Interactive Night on Radio 1 with me, Joe Whiley, and Steve Lamacq, hobnobbing as he does, down at the Cafe Siberia, where Sure Is Pure are going to be playing live in about half an hour's time. We've had a phenomenal response. If you're trying to get through onto our website, if you're trying to download a track, then please be patient, because there are just so many people trying to get through. Phone lines also going completely bonkers. In about 2.5 hours' time, we've got Orbital playing live from their own studio, 15 minutes of completely new stuff. And if you are trying to get through, then you can send us a message. And this is how to do it.
Email us now. interact@bbc.co.uk.
April the 8th will be the first anniversary of the death of Kurt Cobain. You can expect loads of tributes and talk about why it was a significant event, but it also proved significant for the use that fans and pop stars made of the internet. Pete Shelley and the Buzzcocks were on tour with Nirvana in the States just before Kurt died, and the band were due to play support again a few weeks later.
As news started that there was a body found in his place,
I was trying to think of all the different ways I could get information, so there was no, like, news broadcasts going on. And I looked at teletext and there wasn't much happening there. So I thought, I know, I'll go and get in contact with people there in Rottnest to try and find out what's happening.
What else should I be?
Jennifer Nine of Melody Maker followed the Net correspondence closely.
Kurt Cobain's death was probably the first major news event in the pop music world where the internet came into play. What was most affecting was that rather than statements from record companies or the police or whatever, we were getting vox pops from actual Nirvana fans. There were a lot of people speaking very openly about how upset they were, people who had gone down to the vigil that Courtney Love read Kurt's suicide note at.
There was lots of, things from Shock to Serves Him Right. There were lots of Kurt Cobain jokes going around. There's a lot of people flaming about the fact that there were all the jokes and counter flames. It was quite a volatile thing for a while. And also, there was one guy who had actually been to the memorial service, which was on the Sunday, and he emailed me his report about it. So it was almost like having a man on the ground there as well.
Love got involved soon after Kurt's death, but her messages or posts were only being seen by people in a small part of the internet called America Online. Carol Mariconda decided to offer her services as Courtney's postwoman.
She was interested in the public reaction to Kurt's death, and at the time, I think she was sort of isolated and not talking to that many people, and this was a way of sending out her thoughts and also getting reaction from the general public.
Few weeks, all Courtney's messages went via Carol, and also the abusive ones she got in reply.
Some of these people were probably annoyed at her about Kurt's death, and also she's a very provocative person, very inflammatory. There were what she termed math boys, and the math boys went after her and followed up her posts and said that she didn't know how to write an English sentence.
The net also has a very strong male bias, and particularly in the United States, male college students. There's a lot of resentment against a strong person like Courtney Love. If you're sitting in front of your terminal at university and you want to say so-and-so sucks or so-and-so rules, which are the two most common ways of defining pans on the net, unfortunately, it's real Beavis and Butthead land.
Some of Courtney's rock star friends and not-so-good friends joined in too. Trent Reznor of Nine Inch Nails, Billy Corgan of Smashing Pumpkins, and Michael Stipe of REM, who regularly uses the net.
At its best, it's a really great forum for an exchange of information between people who are interested in the same things. At its worst, it's like a high school slam book. It's like a magazine for me.
Michael posted a message to Courtney after she accused him of feeling sorry for her.
He said, no, we didn't have a Florence Nightingale complex, and he truly admired her and thought she was great, and it seemed to settle a misunderstanding. And I just thought that it was really cool and peculiar at the same time that they would come to an understanding of something sort of that intimate on the net.
Courtney's messages to the world touched on the most personal aspects of her relationship with Kurt, especially one incident that happened just before he died.
He called the hotel and they wouldn't put him through because she'd asked for a block on the phone. It was a block on the phone for everyone else but him. And as it turned out, there was a misunderstanding. That was one of the most moving posts that I've read of hers. And she kept repeating the time that the call came in. It was an hour and a minute, and repeated it over and over again. And I don't know if that would have made a difference, but it seemed, the way that she worded it, that it's conceivable that it would have made a difference.